Hi everyone, we are in Tacoma, in the US state of Washington. On July the 1st, 1940, the Tacoma Bridge was inaugurated. It was one of the longest suspension bridges in the world, behind the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco and the George Washington Bridge in New York. This long suspension bridge holds a record. It stood for only 129 days. How is it possible? The bridge spanned the Puget Sound Channel at its narrowest point, the Tacoma Narrows, between Tacoma and the Kitsap Peninsula, near the Gerber. A strait about 4,600 feet wide, with a depth exceeding 197 feet and a strong tidal current, which reach a speed of almost 8.9 miles per hour. The first proposals for a bridge construction date at least to the Northern Pacific Railway's 1899 proposal, but was not taken into consideration. Strong pushes for the construction of the work reappear starting from 1923, and in 1926 the Tacoma Chamber of Commerce approved a fundraising campaign for the construction of a bridge, having the need to reduce the driving distances between Tacoma and the cities on the opposite side of the channel. Only at the end of 1936, the turning point did come, thanks to the expiration of a concession to the ferry boat that linked the two shores and to the increase in public funding in the framework of the President Franklin D. Roosevelt New Deal program. Clark Erich, the State Highways Department's chief project engineer, developed the original bridge design from the late 1937 to spring 1938. His two-lane suspension bridge with a 26-foot track had a 2,600 feet central span and two side spans 1,300 feet each. It was equipped with a reticular deck 39 feet wide, equal to the distance between the cables, and it was 25 feet high. The portal towers had different heights to compensate for the difference in the elevation between the access banks. The Tacoma end was almost 13 feet higher, so the East Tower was 476 feet and 6 inch high, while the West one 463 feet and 6 inch, and featured 5 crossbeams above the deck and 3 below it. But the Erich project will be dramatically changed when the State Toll Bridge Authority requested federal funds from the Public Works Administration, which took on 45% of the construction costs. They ordered Washington state authorities to hire an external consultant with more experience in designing this type of bridge. Leon Salomon Moiseev was appointed, since he was considered one of the greatest authorities in the field of suspension bridges. The Erich project was swept away by Moiseev's pencil, reducing the costs of the work from $11 to $7 million. Moiseev's design had the same basic specifications for carriageway width and center-to-center distance between cables, but increased the span of the center span to 2,800 feet and reduced the depth of the side spans to 1,100 feet. The deck was no longer provided for a generous reticular structure, but it included a pair of plate girders with double T just 8 feet high, making the structure lighter with a ratio between the length of the span and its thickness of 1 to 350. Moiseev didn't share the idea of having towers of different heights and proposed two equal ones, 426 feet high, with two crossbeams above the deck and two below. The project, consisting of 39 panels, was quickly finished in August 1938, and construction began on the 23rd of November. The bridge opened to traffic on July 1st, 1940, and the final cost of the work was $6.6 million. Since the last construction phases, the bridge had shown significant vertical oscillations, which earned it the nickname of Galloping Gertie, precisely because it looked like a galloping horse. Even before its completion in June 1940, inclined cable stays were installed in the middle between the main cables and bridge deck to increase stiffness and reduce the oscillations. Hydraulic buffers were also installed between the floor system of the deck and the towers. Despite the several strategies adopted, after the opening of the bridge, the oscillations continued, and drivers saw cars in front of them rise and fall. At the end of July, a monitoring program was launched. The aim of this study was to correlate wind direction and speed with structural response. Throughout the month of August and the first week of September, the wind speed and the amplitude of the oscillations were recorded continuously. On the 4th of October, in order to stabilize the east span, temporary tie-down cables were installed, connected to anchor blocks. The same operation was repeated 3 days later for the west span. In addition, the engineers of the University of Washington proposed two possible modifications to the bridge to solve the problem of excessive oscillations. A first solution consisted in drilling holes in the lateral girders and along the deck, so that the airflow could circulate through them, in this way reducing lift forces. A second solution aimed at giving a more aerodynamic shape to the transverse section of the deck by adding a curved profile along the span so that the wind flow could diverge above and below the span. But it was too late now. On the morning of November the 7th, by 8, the wind speed had reached 38 miles per hour. Around 8:30, Erich crossed the bridge. He noticed that the oscillations were still lower than those that had affected the work in the past. Therefore, he returned to his office. About 9:30, the slanted cables installed in June snapped or lost their tension, allowing the structure to move more widely. At 9:45, a professor of engineering at the University of Washington, Professor Frederick Bard Farquharson, arrived on site. The bridge was moving with the familiar wave motion that he was studying in the wind tunnel and trying to correct. He brought a movie camera with him to document what was happening. At 10, the last car to pass the bridge was Leonard Cotsworth, a news editor for the Tacoma News Tribune, on his way to the family's summer cottage on the peninsula. In the back seat rode his daughter's dog, a black spaniel named Tuppy. Cotsworth paid the toll and drove onto the rippling span. At 10:03, the central span began to twist inexplicably. It was a phenomenon never seen before. The bridge continued to deform with a torsion on the longitudinal axis up to 45 degrees in one direction and then in the opposite one, with a movement of the cables of about 28 feet. The anemometers measured a wind speed equal to 42 miles per hour. Cotsworth had just passed the East Tower by at least 492 feet when the sway threw his car against the curb. He climbed through an open window and sprawled onto the road. Cotsworth got to his feet and stumbled toward to the direction he had driven from, leaving his dog in the car. At 10:15, Erich returned to the bridge and saw it swaying widely, with the bottom side visible as it tilted. At 10:30, a large chunk of concrete dropped out and fell from the center of the bridge. Photographer Howard Clifford ventured onto the bridge to save Tubby, but he failed and had to turn back. About 10:55, Ferguson, who loved dogs, decided to try to save Tubby. But when he reached into the car, the terrified dog bit his finger. The swings were huge, and the professor stumbled back to the East Tower just in time. At 11, a 600-foot-long section of roadway of the center span beyond the middle of the bridge in the direction of the West Tower fell into the water. This led to a momentary reduction of the oscillations of what remained of the central span. It was the beginning of the oscillation of the side spans as well. At 11:10, what was left of the central span collapsed and plunged into the water. Being a structure designed in balance of forces, this abrupt release of load due to the collapse of the central span caused a violent downward deformation of the side spans and bending towards the coast of the two towers 25 feet high, determining an irreversible plastic deformation. John Carmody, administrator of the Federal Works Agency, appointed a group of senior engineers. Their report became known as the Carmody Board Report, the conclusion of which was that the bridge collapsed due to random effects of turbulence of the wind. This ambiguous explanation was the beginning of attempts to understand the complex phenomenon of wind-induced movement in suspension bridges. So, how is it possible that this bridge collapsed? The cause of the collapse of the Tacoma Bridge is due to a phenomenon of aerelastic instability known as fluttering. With a very low torsional stiffness, this instability, which we can define as a waving of the bridge, gave rise to a change in the structure of the air that hit the bridge itself, generating air motions known as von Karman whirlwinds. The formation of the von Karman vortices was caused by the shape of the cross-section of the deck, which was not aerodynamic at all. These eddies fed the motion of the bridge span to its limit state. After this disastrous collapse, the Tacoma Bridge was rebuilt 10 years later with a project very similar to the Erich's original one, and it's still in place. Its nickname is Sturdy Gertie. In 2007, a second bridge parallel to the first one was inaugurated to cope with the dramatic increase in population. To date, the Tacoma Narrows Bridge is the longest pair of suspension bridges in the world. The case of the collapse of the Tacoma Bridge has had a great resonance within the academic world. In fact, it has favored numerous studies for the improvement of the aerodynamics of larger structures and the development of new monitoring technologies. In addition to the formal developments, the experts have developed simulation systems to test the designs before construction, recreating the wind conditions that will then act on the scale models of the structures.